So we'll give everyone a chance, including myself included.
Yeah, me too.
Before we get started.
Started. I think we'll have a fun wrap to the week. Here we are, day 5 for String Summit, and we are going to have another technique session and discussion with the aid of Mr. Michael Kagan from the Youth Performing Arts School, and I will intersperse things along with Kayla and Tim Blunk here in the class and come around and look with you at things. We're going to do a multi-level session here where we may all be working on the same concept like tremolo or arpeggios or what have you, but we'll do it in whatever fashion is best for your level with modifications as needed. So if we're playing one thing that's a little more advanced and you want to take something that's just a little bit of an introduction to that, that's totally cool. For the schedule today, we have this class until noon, and then we'll have our lunch break. At the 1 o'clock hour, Kayla will play a bit for you, and then we will have a class. Now, we're going to get that class, the 1 o'clock session, we're going to get started just a little bit early today so that we have time for Kayla to play, and then for those of you who want to perform for Kayla's class. During that hour, at the same time, I am on a lecture with the Guitar Foundation of America. So I'll be in my office doing that lecture while you are here in this class doing a session with Kayla. Then at 2 o'clock, we have our student performances. So that's the wrap up to the week with you guys playing whatever you may want to share with an audience. If at 2 o'clock, we don't have a full hour of performances to share, that's okay. We'll just continue with a wrap up discussion of guitar, all things guitar, and any last little tips and advice that you want to hear from me or Kayla or anyone else that's able to join us, okay? So at 12:45, we'll come back here to get started with Kayla's performance in class. And that gives us just a little bit of extra time, and then I'll have to be on that GFA lecture in my office at 1. So we'll collect any information from people who want to play at the 2 o'clock hour at that time. Okay, just it'll be a very informal performance, and that will happen right next door in LL10. It just gives us a little more room to spread out to make it like we're in an audience environment, right? Okay. Great. So, Mr. Kagan, thank you for your patience. I think we're all gathered on the little housekeeping things we needed to do.
Awesome.
And we're set. I'm going to move our camera just a little bit closer so you can see us better. And so you can perhaps see everyone.
That would be awesome. There they are. Hey guys, welcome, welcome.
Great.
Awesome. Well, hey everyone there, and then hey Emmeline, good to see you as well too. Hello, hello. Okay, so I mean, a lot of you are my students, so you get that, but you know, I'm looking for retention here on concepts and ideas, so I wanna go back to Katie's masterclass yesterday. We were talking a lot about vibrato, and Doc, I don't know how the microphone will be in the room, so feel free to translate anything if you don't mind. But
sure, yeah.
But anyway, what were some of what are you thinking about when you're thinking about a vibrato now? What are some concepts or some approaches that are different after Katie's class?
Like, so I was thinking about how you were asking Katie, like, should you put your thumb on the back or not? And I don't even think about that. I just don't put my thumb there at all.
You don't, when you do a vibrato, your thumb picks up naturally, right? Is that what you're saying?
That's just what I do.
Cool. I mean, and I've heard of, Doc, do you have any like counterexamples? Does Sharon Isbin recommend putting more fingers down? Am I remembering that story right? Or is there
that may be, I don't remember it, who may have suggested that exactly or where, but it's certainly a bit of advice that I've heard before and recommend myself depending on the context.
Yes.
You know, another thing to consider about all of this is that vibrato requires us to, in order to make movement in pitch, to move the string. And in the classical style, we tend to do more of the forward to back pushing and pulling the string than the side to side, kind of like B.B. King, Lucille vibrato that you might have. We use that as a trick sometimes, especially if we're like in first position. We want a vibrato note. We might cheat just a little. Sometimes people will do that at the beginning of the barrios. You know, the La Cathedral on that top note, it doesn't get a great vibrato in the side to side. So you might cheat a little and just do it up and down. But so you have to find a way to move the string. So using more fingers is often a good way to do that.
Yeah, so it's never like it's this or that kind of thing. It's like this and that's another option as well too. So I think it's worth having all these tricks to think about because it is very contextual sometimes. And there might be a moment where having my first and third finger might feel better. I hear the pitch changing more for myself than when I do that, which is no finger, one finger and no thumb. I hear more of the side-to-side vibrato. That's easier for me when I do that. So sometimes we may feel like this is nice and loose, but we might not be getting as good of a vibrato. So anyway, but context is everything for all of this. So, but this is something new for you to think about. So when you're trying to get to a musical end, you can think, okay, I'm gonna try no thumb. Okay, now I'm gonna try adding extra fingers. And then you have to record it, listen to it, be objective with it, and see if it makes a difference. These are the experiments that we have to make. Okay, so Peyton, this is wonderful. So the thing that you brought to the table here was thumb pressure or adding fingers and how that affects vibrato. Okay, anything else? What else do you all remember from our discussion on vibrato?
Hey, what's your biggest takeaway from it? You were right there in the performer's role. What do you remember most about it? Okay, yeah. So how the vibrato changes is based upon where you do the vibrato. So you mean along the string? Yeah. So she's remembering how the vibrato will change if you're at the 12th fret, say versus at the seventh fret versus that first position, maybe third.
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
Right.
They all bring something. There's a unique challenge. They're all a little bit different in a way. And that changes things. Like, you know, when you're, if you're playing, you know, Dr. Mattingly was just mentioning the Barrios piece just a moment ago, but when you have some strings that are open and some that are pressed down, this changes your arpeggio technique. So yeah, really, because the height of the strings are different. So yeah, it really does, these are all variables. What was the exercise we did to practice changing pitch? Do you remember that one?
We were somewhere like here. We did it.
Let's revisit that one. I think that's one of the becomes very clear if you can do that, because again, what ends up happening, you know, Dr. Mattingly just mentioned the kind of like B.B. King kind of vibrato here, but when we do that, we're often only change, it's like we have the pitches right here, this is the note, we're often only going just above in pitch, we're only raising it and then going back there. But if you listen to a great singer, when they sing a note, this is the note, they're going above and below it at about 6 oscillations per second. That's like the, you know, the most desirable opera vibrato is that. So we want to be able to adjust our pitch here. So let's do the second string, 7th fret. Let's use our third finger. And again, let's just play the note real quick. You can do a rest stroke if you like, free stroke, whatever's good. We'll just do straight tone. Now what we're going to do is we're going to keep your pressure, but lean to the left. And you'll hear the pitch raise. And then lean to the right. And you'll hear it getting lower. And then, you know, if feel free to hop to a different string. Try a different location. Experiment for a little bit.
Stronger and snap it in half. Our fingers are the same way. All of our joints and tendons and ligaments and all of the things going into our fingers are movable. So as we do that vibrato and we move the string, our finger is bending with it, meaning there's less of that energy going into the string. So we lose some of what would be if our string was more fixed by, like, you know, a force more stable than a finger. So by adding more fingers, you add to that shared energy between the fingers into the string and bend it more easily. That's with 3 fingers. That's with just 1. You hear how distinct difference that is? You immediately hear the amount of pitch changes greater, right?
Yes, that's great. So let's actually add that variable to it then. So now let's play the 7th fret on the first string. Let's put down our 2nd finger on the 6th fret, and let's put our first finger down on the 5th fret and try that same exercise.
Some of you have it tucked way back here, like
sure it doesn't go behind the neck.
No, you may like have it like Mr. Kagan has it out of the way to show you clarity of what he's doing. But in a performance situation, we would have that fourth finger ready to go, not back here behind the neck, right?
Great. And then we maybe had just one more concept that I wanted to talk about. And then Dr. Mangley, as we were just kind of brainstorming an exercise regarding this one. So what do guitarists tend to do with their vibrato in terms of duration? Do they front load it, back load it? What's the tendency? Do they hold it for the whole note? What do guitarists tend to do?
Yeah, a little shake. Yeah, they just give it a little shake and then nothing else.
Yes, that's right. So they front load it. But if you listen, and if, again, the more singers you listen to, if it's a more operatic one, it might be for the whole duration of it. If you listen to someone that's singing musical theater, they'll do a straight tone for a little while, and then they'll shake their note a little bit towards the end. These are all different variants here that we can imitate. But I think what's important for all of us here is that we tend to front load it, and we tend to not do it for long enough. So, Doc, do you want to give your little chromatic exercise real quick, and we'll do some counting out loud with that?
Yeah, we can do that. Yeah. So to start off, we'll do just chromatic notes 1, 2, 3, 4. Your fingers at the fifth position, third string. So go to the third string, fifth fret with your first finger, and we're just going to play 1, 2, 3, 4. That pattern: C, C sharp, D, D sharp, D, D flat, C. Back and forth like that. And we'll assume that each of these note values is a half note. And we're gonna just kind of count it as if we're in 4-4. And what I want us to do is, here we have, so if we did it without vibrato, it would be a straight tone exercise like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. At the rate of an eighth note. So I'm going to do the eighth note division in my vibrato, meaning I'm going back and forth with my fingers at an eighth note rate. And it sounds like this. 1 and 2 and 1 and 2 and 1 and 2 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 4 and 1 and 2 and. Kind of like that. Now, there's another phase of this, or a way of doing this, that will add to it, but I was kind of wondering what would happen if we did it in here, fifth position first, and everyone just try that with us, okay? So let's do the, just to get ourselves oriented to this exercise, let's do the straight tone, no vibrato version, no vibrato at all, and we'll do half notes. Right hand doesn't really matter, but I'm going to do
I am restroke with my thumb planted on the fifth string in good form in the right hand as well. Okay, so when I say right hand doesn't matter, it means the finger combination doesn't matter, but still strive to reinforce those good habits of right hand form and technique as you play anything. So here we go, ready, chromatic, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and go vibrato. 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and. Yeah, I'm keeping my fingers down as I go. Yeah, so I have all of those fingers down, and then I just lift and I send them back down. There we go. Good. Now let's try that with the eighth note vibrato. 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and.
That's great. And did anyone experience in the room when Dr. Mangley said don't do vibrato, was that like unnatural for some people? Yeah. Good for you. That's a good
thing.
Yeah, yes. So we always want to be thinking of these expressive elements like that. That's wonderful. Okay. So really, this is such a big, important concept for all of us, that again, that we're thinking about how many fingers do we have down, thumb pressure. We're thinking about changing the pitch from side to side, sharpening it, flattening it. And we're also thinking about the duration that we hold it for, not just front loading it and then stopping it, but letting it be for the whole duration. So all of my students, we end up doing scales in the classroom, and this is the perfect thing. You know, sometimes we think whole note scales like, ugh, I want to play my scales fast. I want to play at 100 BPM, otherwise I'm not doing anything for myself. No, you can do a lot for your technique by just playing through. I'm leaving fingers down. I practice picking them up. There's so many ways that you can apply these concepts to other aspects. And they're worth more to you when you apply them in different situations. They really, really are. So when you go home today or in a break, whatever, try it in a couple different ways. Really, really, I can't encourage you enough. Okay, good for vibrato for now, maybe, but let's jump a little bit more to tremolo. I'm doing a share screen real quick. Let's see. Okay, everybody, so let's do a couple. We've kind of been left-hand focused to start here. I want to review a couple concepts, and then we'll talk about arpeggios that help tremolo today. And then I have a couple more exercises for you. And just like Dr. Mattingly said, do as much as you can. If an exercise that uses both hands needs to only be the right hand for you, that's fabulous. That's okay. Most of the technique that we're working on right now is centered on the right hand. So the left hand's just for kind of your ears, just for fun.
Hey, Mr. Kagan, I have a quick question. Can I interject just one question?
Yeah, of course.
So before we go to tremolo, just to close out that thought on vibrato, now this is something that could branch off like into an entirely different class, but I'll just put it out there as a question, as a seed, a kernel for you to let flourish throughout the rest of the summer. Body awareness is an important thing. And I wonder if you could think about what is the source of that vibrato that we just did. What, meaning where in your body, where in your arm does that vibrato even come from? Is it in your fingertip? Is it in your knuckle? Is it in your wrist? Is it in your elbow? Is it in your shoulder? Is it in your neck? Physically, I mean, right? Because if you say in your brain, then yeah, obviously all of it is from that. Okay, so just think about that. And maybe we'll kind of give that some thought and then observe what happens to your body in response to some of these things. Remember how we said the nervous system is a two-way street? It's kind of even more than a two-way street. It's kind of a three or four-way street. But some of you are doing vibrato and you're instantly doing like, you know, your whole body is responding to it. That's great for like audience interaction to get, you know, you've got to learn all your guitar faces. It sometimes is a sign that you're holding tension. So just throwing that out there.
Oh yeah, totally. And oh my gosh, that is just like you said, it becomes such a vivid conversation, and there's different players you should all be familiar with for different reasons. But someone like a hero for many of us in the room, like Yamashita, he is what a big mover, but nothing is wasted for that guy. It's all helping his performance. It really is. I don't see anything being superfluous in a way. I don't see anything getting in his way by doing that. Then you look at someone like Manuel Barueco, who is so still, just very like regal on the stage. And that's beautiful to watch too. But I would imitate Manuel before imitating Yamashita, just as a teacher here. And then I Doc, we kind of forgot that one last exercise maybe we can do just as a tactile way to kind of maybe come to that.
Yeah, so
maybe,
yeah.
I apologize. Let's add just one more vibrato thing, and this is gonna be good. So again, there's just so many ways we can explore this exercise here, but let's put our pinky on the 12th fret on the second string. And again, you all, again, the experiment right now is you could do just the pinky by itself, or at any point, if you get bored, put down three, two, and one as well. But what I want you to try for the moment is do a vibrato on the 12th fret, and then notice that your hypothenar, or the kind of the heel of your hand here, feel it as you're doing the one and two, and feel it hitting the bout of the guitar. And maybe that's going to give you some more insight on to where some of the movement is coming from, because it is coming from many places. Let's see if you can get that feedback. So if you have a tendency to not hold your vibrato for the full length of time, you will feel if you stop. So let the bout of the guitar be this tactile feeling for it. And then you might also notice some other things about your shoulder joint or your wrist rotation as well as you're doing that. Great, and I really think these things are important, to do these little kind of body awareness things. Really get into your hands each morning. So if you're doing a little, do that same exercise that we did a moment ago, but do it in ninth position. I'm feeling that tactile thing right there. You know? Okay, awesome. Sorry, we could talk for a full hour straight and on this if we wanted to. So I'm gonna jump for a little bit. Let me jump to the tremolo sequence here. Let's review a couple concepts here, and I'll kind of serve to get our right hand a little warmed up if it's not warmed up already. Okay, so friends, the first exercise that I had for you was just starting off with an A finger stroke. So again, you're thinking about wrist height, you're thinking about the direction of using the big knuckle. So start with just a couple strokes with the A finger. I know all my students know that I do this, but now you're getting a little bit more of a reason why. And again, the pitch is going to follow. And again, it's not pulling up like that. Pinky's not doing that. It's all this uniform direction. And you're focusing on the tone as well, too. Because when oftentimes, not even for tremolo, when we're playing, I don't know, a piece like Lagrima, for example, or many pieces, it's oftentimes the A finger has to have a very beautiful melodic round tone, and these are your accompaniment. It happens a lot. So we want to make sure that our A finger sounds quite beautiful. Okay, and then we were using this as a means of understanding tremolo more. The next exercise was putting both your A and M finger on the first string. We were talking about body awareness just a moment ago with vibrato. This is the same thing right now. I'm feeling that by putting both fingers on the string, I'm feeling the release. And right now, my nails are in good shape. I don't feel any resistance. But if you do, you might need to shape your nails a little bit differently. And we also talked about placing some sandpaper around the first string as well as a means of satisfying that. So anyway, I won't do my nails in front of you right now, but just practice, just do A and M on the first string. And you should feel a nice continuity of both fingers. If it's getting stuck, one of the nails might need to be fixed. And this is going to be a major problem in your tremolo if you don't have this right. The last thing that David Russell recommends to do is just put A, M, and I all on the first string. So it's three fingers on one string. It's kind of a weird stroke, but it definitely helps.
You remember on Tuesday I gave that little bit of a and you will probably end up changing your technique to adapt to a bad nail, or you will train yourself to become familiar and comfortable with bad tone. And that's not a good thing.
Totally. Yeah. And you know, And then you can, there's so many layers to that as well. And it's so important to get this right. Cause I think, especially for the first thing, cause we've been talking about body awareness. If you don't realize how your nails are subtly affecting your technique, you're making all these little micro compensations, you might get to a certain point where you plateau, and then it's hard. It's really tricky to go through all that. So it's worth getting the nails right. I often use fake nails. Right now I have my own natural ones, but find what works for you and just commit to it. It's not worth having to adjust your technique later or anything like that. So, okay, let's do another quick warm up. If you all remember the Malaguena progression, marvelous. If not, we're just gonna, you can do just E major here. So in my left hand, I have, let me zoom in a little bit because I know Emmeline's probably hard to see this on the virtual side of things here. Okay, hopefully that's good. Okay, no matter where you are, let's take a moment to go through some of this exercise. So if nothing else, put down your second finger on E, fourth fret, second string, and your first finger on G sharp, first fret, third string. If you're good with reading the rest of the notation, awesome, okay? Our first exercise is gonna be to play through this, but we're gonna do P and A. Switch to PM. Okay. Ready and go. And one more repeat. Now, last one, ready and go. And jump to some other, I'm going to go to some newer material for a moment, and then we'll fold some of this older stuff back in. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this is a new exercise for us all here. So I'll just read through it here. What I mentioned in the beginning of my class with you guys on, I guess on Monday, tremolo helps arpeggios, which helps tremolo, which helps arpeggios, and the cycle just keeps going and going, the virtuous circle. So this exercise is from Scott Tennant. He's one of the founding members of Los Angeles Guitar Quartet, like Bill Cannon-Geyser, who we were just talking about with vibrato. What we're gonna do for this exercise, we're gonna practice planting each finger individually with sequential planting, aiming for an even sound and volume and tone. And like I mentioned before, what this is really great at is it helping us integrate a hand position that complements both techniques. And if there's an issue somewhere in there, could be a nail shape that we're compensating for, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so it's gonna start off just open strings here. We're gonna do thumb on the fourth string, then we'll do A on the first string. We plant our M finger on the second string. As soon as I play M, I place I. As soon as I play I plant P. P, A, M, I, P, A. Join in for a couple. Emily, does this feel good for you? Can you give me a thumbs up if it's okay? Awesome. Proud of you. That's great. Okay. Just to, I know I have a wide variety here of people with different experiences, so I would just say do what's comfortable. But for those of you that have a little bit more background, you can set the metronome 4 notes per click and play this at 100, 120. Tremolo typically starts at the 16th note equal, rather a quarter note, 4 notes equaling around 120. So aspire for that as well. Okay, let's move on to this next one here. We're gonna do PAMI, but now we're gonna play 2 notes on the B string. So we're gonna play, it's still sequential prep. So it's gonna be thumb on the 4th string, A finger on the 1st, middle finger on the 2nd, that's all the same, but then we play the I finger on the 2nd string. So P, A, M, I.
Mr. K, if you do that one, I have a question to clarify with the class.
Sure.
So when we're playing the sequence of P, A, M, I, whether on separate strings or on the same string, what's happening with the flexion and extension of the fingers in this cycle? So the preparation is happening one after another sequentially. But what about when I play A, the A finger, I've just plucked that, and then I have prepared M.
Uh-huh.
Now what happens with A? Does it stay flexed or does it bounce back out?
No, I wanna keep it flexed.
Yeah. So in the end, we end up with A, M, and I all flex into the hand, and then the thumb's prepared. So kind of like almost a thumbs up symbol.
Yep.
And then the thumb plays, and then when we go to the extension, what happens when the thumb plays and A prepares? Do M and I go back out then, or do they stay flex?
Oh, this is an interesting question here, because there's and guide me here as well too for this. Oftentimes, if you think like a pedagogue, like someone like Aaron Shear, they're kind of like, we often think of the index being the left foot and this kind of being the right foot in a way. So sometimes they'll recommend, and Stanley Yates says something very similar too with a compound stroke as well. So you could, and again, Doc, please, if you've seen more success with a different version or another, please chime in. But you could have A and M. Right now my A finger is on the string, but M is like pretty close to the 2nd string as well. So it's almost like they went out as a unit.
Right.
How do you feel about this sort of idea of unit prep, or do you think there's a more simpler way of sharing that concept?
No, what I see is that we basically, in one thing that I practice with tremolo and arpeggio as a complementary exercise is rastiato. And sometimes when you're doing rastiato, you'll find techniques where all of your fingers are going out at once, say like in that E major chord, you know, you might put all those fingers out in a fanning type motion or in a motion like that. I think A, M, and I all extend together. That is after P plays, A prepares, and that's the moment when A, M, and I all go out. And they hopefully, if we're doing a tremolo on a single string, they go out and make kind of like a fan type gesture. So it looks as if the fingers M and I are lined up to land on the same string that A has just prepared already, or maybe extended just a bit beyond. But that way your sympathetic motion as you just go AMI and close the hand means that M and I are going to hit that string, make good contact with that string, just as A did. A vision that I had for this was one time I can remember landing at LAX, the Los Angeles International Airport, and seeing that going as far as you could see out into the Pacific, there were planes all lined up one after another for the runway. And they were all going to follow that same glide path, but distant enough that they were in line. That's kind of what I imagine when I think of tremolo with my fingers. Hopefully, I get them all lined up to land on that runway. But we need to rethink it not as a runway on Earth, but maybe like a battleship that you're trying to land on an aircraft carrier, I mean. So you're trying to land on this aircraft carrier in the middle of the ocean. That's what guitar playing is.
every single note our right hand plays, it's like landing on an aircraft carrier. Way more opportunity to miss than there is to hit the thing. So that's why aim-directed motion is so important, right? You aim at a thing, and you don't try not to miss. You try to hit that one thing.
That's anyway, true. My thought. Oh, no. That's brilliant. And then, I mean, so I guess one of the big takeaways there is, like, if your hand looks like this, it's just going to be a little too slow to do something like that. Maybe it's a practice technique to get a little bit more independence in your fingers, but the difference, what we're discussing here is option one is this versus,
yeah,
and you can see how by bringing the fingers out, A's prepped, and then these just sympathetically just close the hand out, and that feels very natural. And that's the way that our hands, how we evolved and how we brachiate is that way. So it just feels such a natural feeling. So as we play these exercises now, that might be worth thinking about here. So if we're looking at this sort of, I don't know if you guys can see my cursor or not, but if we look at the second one, we'll play P, but I have A, M is hovering over the string, and then I's, you know, is I slightly, I don't know, maybe ever so slightly flexed, but I've released it. It's definitely not flexing in my palm anymore. So again, noticing, this is what we're not looking for. Sorry. We're looking for, bring your fingers out together as a unit. Let's do that together here, thinking about this unit here of opening the hand, okay? So we'll do P, A, M, I, 4, 1, 2, 2. There's a couple more, to be perfectly honest with you here, but let's go to this third one now. So now we're going to play, the strings we're going to play are going to be 4 1 1 2, same P A M I, and again you're thinking of this kind of big unit extension here. P A M I is on the third string. There's a slight fist. As soon as I play my thumb, the fingers release. Good. I'm hearing you guys from here. This is wonderful. And then the last one is the actual tremolo now. So it's 4 1 1 1. Noticing that unit prep again. It's not this, but it's out together. Okay. Sorry. I'll get you into it. Lovely, guys. Awesome. Well done. I'm going to expand upon these exercises a little bit by changing the rate at how quickly we change between movement forms. So just take a moment to kind of pre-read this. Every single one's P-A-M-I on open strings, but you have different string combinations. So we're going 4-1-2-3-4-1-2-2-4-1-1-2-4-1-1-1. And then it's like a palindrome here or something like that. So it's going to be the same way, backwards and forwards. Okay. So let's give this one a shot. Hopefully you guys can all see it well enough. Okay. I'm just going to read through it. Ready and go. And well done. Awesome. Okay. Let's take a moment to pre-read this next one here. So we're switching basically between an arpeggio and a straight tremolo. So it's going to be 4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3, then 4-1-1-1-4-1-1-4-1-2-3-4-1-2-3-4-1-1-1. Okay. Ready and go. And okay, we're gonna keep going. I just want to make a little aside here. We were talking a little bit about one of my favorite coffee table books, Steal Like an Artist by Austin Kleon, and he recommends journaling what some of your activities are throughout the day. And this is a perfect example where I would, if Doc has printed this out for you, if not, we'll make sure you have a PDF. Write down whatever your last tempo was on it, your last comfortable tempo, and keep write the date, keep growing with it. I know some of these exercises seem basic, but it's so fundamental. And if you can't take this up to a pretty fast level, you probably won't get your tremolo where you want it either. Okay, so just want to encourage you guys to take this, grow with it, and chart your own progress with it as well.
So, Mr. Keegan, I have a quick question as you're there on that, two little things on that topic about journaling. We have that in our technique packet that I shared with you guys it on the second day. Remember we were talking about like setting a schedule and then setting goals and then taking notes on how you achieve that or not? That's all really good to do. One thing that I did, a thing that can be an inhibitor to journaling, is that the journal itself being something difficult to get to. So figure out whatever way is best for you to feel comfortable to write things down. If it's a digital thing on your screen already, then just use any kind of note-taking thing that you have there and start taking those notes. It doesn't have to be super formalized as long as it's something you'll understand when you go back to it later. It could even be a voice text thing if you just want to do it really fast. My version of that in the before times when we used writing implements on paper products was I took my practice room in Germany had a wall that I just took a cardboard cutout from a refrigerator. Like when I bought my refrigerator, it came in this cardboard box, and I had that big piece of cardboard tacked to the wall. And I would take a Sharpie and just write. I had every single finger combination of arpeggios and every single finger combination of scales, and I would just continue to keep a list of the date and the number that I have. And so by the end, it would look like, you know, as I often say, the ratings of a madman on the wall, or, you know, just lists of things, but it would be something that I should look at very quickly and see. And I would see the goal kind of tracking along, like, oh, so last week I could only play that at 110 BPM, and this week I can now play it at 115 BPM. Something like that. It's helpful to be able to see it quickly.
Yes, and then just one more thing on it, just because I'm a very emotionally sensitive person here too. Never let what you had at one point become this sort of outcome dependence that you get it the next day. Just let it be something that, oh, this is great. It's a great piece of information, but you got to be a scientist with it sometimes too, and not be overly emotional about it. There's lots of reasons. You could be stressed out. Maybe you didn't play as much. Maybe your nails aren't in good same shape. Don't direct hatred at yourself for this. Just use it as information. Be like, well, I've been able to play PIM arpeggios at 120 before. I know I can do it. I'll have to just work my way back up to it. But just be sensitive to that too. And if you're riding a wave with journaling, you probably will see your progress more likely than not. But also, if it doesn't go the way that you want, that's okay too. You know, we have a long musical life ahead of us. And there's I might be able to close out my tremolo talk here a little bit in a couple minutes with a recording that I really love by Pablo Sanz-Viegas. Now, he's playing fast. He's a guitar virtuoso. Let's make no doubts about it. But in terms of all the recordings I heard of Recuerdos, it's probably the slowest one that I know of, and I think it's gorgeous. So
that brings up a question that I had about tremolo, Mr. Kagan.
Sure.
What are you thinking about the deviation of the right hand in use of tremolo on a single piece of arpeggio versus tremolo? Do you ascribe to that school of thought, deviate when you do tremolo, or do you keep your wrist exactly the same position for both arpeggio and tremolo?
For myself, I think, and we were talking a little bit with this with Ella as well, where again, sometimes I think what the danger that people often get into is that their A finger is a little bit too long. And I think for this, what ends up being my way that I've gotten around this is that if I bend from this middle joint, I bring my arm a little bit more forward. So, I mean, am I mostly keeping the same deviation? Yes, but I have a little bit more middle joint flexion, which brings my arm a little bit more forward. And that's something that works for me. So again, an arpeggio might look like this, and then my tremolo might be a little bit more forward like that. How do you feel about that?
Well, I like it. I'll just show on the screen a little closer. There are some schools of thought that you can you want to share your screen, and then we'll see. I'll see if I can make my screen bigger for everyone in here too. Because that's actually a nice thing if I can use my screen as a way to show everyone in the room a little bit. So here we are. The one thought is that so I might be set up for an arpeggio something like this with a more straight wrist, where I'm playing the thumb A and I in succession there. And then as I play tremolo, I deviate so that I get a straight line with these knuckles on the string that's playing tremolo, the first string in that case. That's just one school of thought, that you get those fingers in line that way by deviating at the wrist from the tremolo. What another alternative to that would be that you're essentially keeping the same orientation there in the wrist, not deviating toward the ulnar side, but keeping it straight. And then when you extend your eye finger, which have to, just by virtue of its distance, have to extend further than your A finger does. So then you're going to get a look where your eye finger seems to momentarily straighten out more so than your A finger is as it completes that stroke and follows through.
And then the other variable to that too, depends on, you know, how much tilt do you like in your playing as well too. I tend to have a little bit more tilt in my, I mean, I go back and forth. I experiment constantly too. And if I'm using fake nails versus real nails, sometimes, like I said, sometimes these things will adjust a little bit. But because I tend to, like, again, this bone right here that's on our thumb side right here is our radius. This is how I want to make sure I have a better frame here. This is how we rotate with this bone right here. So I tend to be a little bit, imagine just looking at your watch. I tend to be a little bit more like this when I play as well. So for me, it's more about the how much middle joint flexion I have. But if I were playing more like this, I could see where you would want to probably deviate a little bit more. Does that make sense?
This is exactly a thing out of the federal government.
Yes.
I tend to use a bit of it. When I go to play tremolo, I like to get my eye finger a little bit closer so that I can avoid that tendency for the eye finger to reach and kind of lift.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
It seems to help me get a little more organized in my motion, a little more. But anyway, you had a video
here. Yeah, let's go over the last little bit here. Gosh, well, guys, you'll have this packet, and there's a lot of good stuff here. The last exercise just kind of switches back a little bit more frequently between the arpeggio and the tremolo, and that's sort of kind of why Dr. Magley and I just had this conversation here about. What does your tremolo position look like versus what does your arpeggio position look like? So let's maybe close out with one exercise, and then we'll watch just a very just 2 or 3 minutes of a piece. So our last one is going to be arpeggio 4-1-2-3 followed by 4-1-1-1, and the kind of variables that Dr. Magley are giving you is you have this ability to deviate your wrist, so you can go a little bit more like this, or you can preserve your position if you have enough tilt in your hand and just come a little bit more forward. Lots of ways of approaching this. So let's go through this one real quick. Here. I left some other kind of fun things here. So again, those of you that have some more experience, you might want to try these 5-note tremolos, or even incorporating your pinky into the mix. But more on that maybe next year or another time. And so many good ones here. You'll have to explore with your teachers on your own. What I want to leave you with here is just a quote from one of the masters. Tremolo does not have to be played fast in order to sound great. Simple, but very true words. I want to show you a very modest, again, it's still going to be very impressive, but in the grand scheme of things, this is a relatively slow tremolo here.
Can you turn it up? Pretty soft on our end. Oops. So now we haven't heard it at all, Mike.
You might have to share his sound.
Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Yeah.
That's absolutely it. Yeah. Sorry, we do Google Meets, we do Teams, we do everything these days, so I always forget. Okay, I'm sensitive of the time, and I know you guys have lunch there, but there's, again, this is sort of insider baseball here. This might not be so interesting for everybody here, but there's the typical tremolo starts around 120 BPM, and there's lots of moments here where he's only playing at 108. I mean, I know it's in the ballpark, but it's on the slower side for many of that, and it's just, but his tone is so beautiful. And there's this, the sound isn't being stopped prematurely, so it just has this feeling of such a long duration. So anyway, one of my favorite recordings of Recuerdos.
And he
Well, I had some.
also did something with the left hand that was interesting. Did anyone familiar with the piece catch what he did differently in the left hand? Tough to catch unless you play the piece a lot. The part where the line goes up the second string, he re-fingered things a lot to keep it on the first string.
Yeah, I decided to do that too, 'cause I like it, 'cause you get the you can get that instead of having the I always kind of got annoyed by that, a little, well, annoyed after hearing this recording at least. So having that, there's a way to refinger this stuff where you can have the G and C ringing over each other. So it's very cool. Well, friends, I had so much fun. I hope you got some new concepts here, some new things to practice over the summer. Be thinking about vibrato, be thinking about tremolo, journal consistently, take ideas from places. We were talking a little bit about artistic family trees yesterday as well too. So whoever your favorite artists are, study who inspired them and kind of find more about yourself. That's sort of the great journey we're all on here as artists and musicians. So, okay.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Kagan. Thanks so much.
My pleasure. All right, I'll be in touch. Bye,
Okay.
guys.
We'll be back on here this time at about 12:45. See everyone then.
All right.
this afternoon session, the 1 o'clock session, just a bit early, just a little bit early, so that we have time for Kayla's performance, and then I'm going to transition over to a lecture that I'm giving with the Guitar Foundation of America Virtual Convention. That's at 1 o'clock Eastern Time, 10 Pacific Time. For that lecture, the remainder of the hour, but Timothy Blunk, Asher, Taylor Schrader, and Kayla Hibbs will all be here in the room. Kayla giving some lessons and tips to the students in that 1 o'clock hour. And then at 2 o'clock, we are holding a small student performance next to an LL10. Okay, so that'll be a voluntary performance. It will only be on Zoom for families who want to watch that. Great. Okay, so let's see, we're gonna start with Kayla's performance. So Kayla, you wanna come on up here and have a seat in the performance chair. Got the mic close to you.
And I'll bring this camera a little closer. Get this out of the way. Just stand there. You want me to? You can turn a little bit toward the class, and then I'll move your camera.
Wait.
Yep. Yeah, so you want to face the class a little bit more definitely. There we go.
So I'm going to play Capriccio Arabe. Arabe, I think I said that right. Yeah. So.
Yeah. Put your stand off to the side a little bit. Body will find to see a little better. There you go. That's fine.
Okay. Thank you. It should. You might have to put my music style. But it should.
Studios?
Yeah.
And if I put Louisville, then we'll be able to find the search further.
No, it's in our Facebook, the website. Oh, wait.
This is down here?
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, Facebook comes up faster because yeah. It's connected to Facebook. But hey, look at that.
Yeah.
So this is the studio that Kayla runs. We have classes and in person and online lessons, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So just putting this up here, you guys to see. Share it on this too, so it's on our screen. And then this is where Kayla has started this. Virtual and in-person music studio. They're based in Louisville, and she has students online from what, as far away as California, right?
Yeah, a brother and sister from California.
Yeah.
Found us on Instagram.
Yeah, so there you go. You've got a little bit of info there about the studio itself. I'm going to put it back on the regular screen here so we can adjust the camera and have a live session here. Cool. All right. So now, if you have played before, you can still play again for Kayla and Asher and Tim can add to the discussion as it goes on. And if you are out of time or ideas or just want to have a little bit of fun, we've got the duo that we never got around to the other day. Right? So we can play some of that. I will be back downstairs to help with the 2 o'clock hour once I finish this lecture that I have upstairs. And things just really get ahead in the schedule. You guys can prep for that performance. You just like have a little bit of guitar chaos in there and prepare to play that. Cool. All right. See you just there.
Would anybody like to play? Okay.
I'm already warmed up and I was like, I'm not sitting here.
Oh. Let's see, I think.
Like, do you want to have this one
out
there?
Yeah. You don't have to read from it, but it'll be nice to have it.
All right. Do I have to, like, pull it off
No.
Oh, I was about to say, like,
you don't know
pull
how.
It off
there? Oh, do you know how?
No, I don't know. I just want to know who wanted to do it, because I would not know.
Yeah, I don't either.
Can you go first in the school?
Yeah, for sure. Play
like right. slow, and then when we hit like a trouble spot, we'll stop and figure out what is going on. All right. Making it hard. All right. I think you're doing it right there.
Okay. You
see when it's four there?
Yeah, but
do that. Because then you can use your third finger, your second finger, and your first finger there. That'll eliminate the shift.
Okay.
But you know, it's kind of fall in place one at a time.
Hard.
I would even do it. I don't think you need all of these at once. You can just do like the sequential planting of this. Then you have your third finger, then second, then this.
Oh, yeah. I really hate that method.
Too. This one?
No, this one right here. Like,
you see that much?
Down, like, should I keep the G sharp down?
You don't come back, too, but I would, you know, it does come back, so I wouldn't, because they do have that rest there, so I would just like lift the pressure but leave it there so that it'll stop ringing, and I would have your third finger kind of hovering over F sharp, like ready to play.
That's right here.
Yeah, like, early, the better. Even if they're just hovering over where they're going to be.
Yeah.
And then, you're doing a second finger then? Was that right?
Yeah.
Okay. And then it just has to go back to the A.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's try from... Is this a good spot for you?
Yeah.
Maybe like there to there really slow. Let's see if we fix some of that.
Right. That's like. I took my thumb off of the vibrato right here. Well, I'm actually, that would not work.
I have to get that down. Do you guys ever take your thumb off completely?
Okay.
Do it for the vibrato or for the shifting and stuff?
More for vibrato?
Yeah.
Shifting?
I feel like I use my thumb to shift. Yeah. That's how I feel too. Like, I kind of use my thumb for shifting to like build the neck. Vibrato, though, I guess. Thank you.
It's always nice to think about phrasing and stuff like that. The value of it is that you can figure a place to put a little bit of space so that you can keep your hands more time to prepare. Sometimes I feel like I'm playing a game of connected dots where I'm trying to get all the notes dot.
Yeah.
And then that nice phrase, you could add a little bit of space like da 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 da.
Yeah.
So when you go up high, you have like the tiniest little breath of space. And then you have a little bit more time to get to the lower notes and then come up to the gates.
Yeah, okay.
And I feel like that happens in a lot of places in this piece. That's probably you have the glissando. That's another area where there's time for that breath of space to round off the cadence. And I don't know specifically where the piece, I don't know the piece that well, I feel like that's one thing that I'm hearing a lot of these angular phrases and sub phrases where some spacing would be nice to help your left hand prepare some stuff, right?
Yeah, definitely. Like I was thinking about how a couple days ago Dr. Mangler was saying that like when you're playing guitar, you only get like 1/8 of the breath that you should have. Mm-hmm. And I'm always like, oh, this piece is gonna be so good. I'm gonna be so calm. And then I get in there and I'm like out of control. It's just like, like.
You can even like write in, like I always have to do is just write in breath marks.
Yeah.
Like for phrasing so that I'll stop for a second and breathe.
Yeah.
And think about how you would like breathe while singing the piece.
Yeah.
I don't sing my music, but I like internalize the phrasing a lot, and I think about the way I would say the articulation. So I can't sing the pitches accurately after just giving the listen to, but I know the phrasing that I would want to do. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da. So I have like normal notes in there, legato notes in there, and staccato. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da. So normal at the beginning, the staccato high note, and then legato leading up to my last one. That is a way for me to have a little bit more control and fight that feeling of trying to connect the dots and that rush sense of I need to get all these notes. Now, sometimes I need to like treat some of the notes a little better and give them more space, and that's going to help me in the end because I'll be able to take more time. Away from
I agree. I think just like shaping it and stuff, like even in that spot we were looking at where you have that slide, like you were talking about the glissando, I think just sliding to and letting us hear that note. You can add some vibrato if you want from Thingy Glass, and really bring that one out.
I need to write in like parts where I need to like just stop and like let the note breathe for a little bit. I could just do that now. So I want to do it in like that slide right there. I don't know what to. I'm next to like, a star.
You can write like vibrato, or you can also do this. this little line, like a tenuto, just needs to like hold on to it a little bit longer.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's usually under the note. I don't know why I put it there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Vibrato. And then let me think about other places where I might want to add that. Like,
yeah.
I feel like this section over here on the first page is like all like slow and nice, and then this one's just like out of control.
So that's probably like a good spot to add some.
But yeah, this one I feel like it just gets crazy.
Yeah. Well, like you can add one there where you just stopped, because that's like a pickup into a new section.
Yeah.
So maybe like a little breath.
Wait, where is it?
Those are notes
that we just said?
Yeah, the previous section. Like the second you were on first.
Oh, yeah, that one.
Oh,
I know what you're talking about, though.
Yeah. Yeah, but you like, no.
I've had that same issue too, like the slurs especially. I always want to rush slurs, so make sure that those especially, like any rhythm, there's a lot of slurs in here, like in these fast sections. Sometimes I'll take the slur out and practice it.
Yeah,
just like a normal note so I can hear what it's supposed to sound like.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Are there any other like certain spots that have given you trouble or given you questions?
Like not really. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, that reminds me. I've been trying to, speaking of like breath marks, like I didn't even like, I remember one time Dr. Nang like called me out and he was like, there's a rest here, baby.
These sometimes are built in breath marks.
Yeah, I know, I really like that though.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah.
But I want, I want to add some more like breath marks, but I can do that on my own time.
Just playing, like I would just go through real slow and find any good, like an end of the phrase is a good spot to just take a breath.
Yeah,
and like highlighting these melody notes and the really high notes that are, and that might be the highest one in the whole piece. And a glissando, so that's a good spot to really like bring some attention to.
Yeah.
So, cool.
Okay.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Well, yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Does anyone else want to play?
Like that.
Oh, okay.
Like you played it a lot better than I would. Oh. So.
Well, I.
I left it on my electric at my house, I think.
Oh, y'all use that one.
Looks like from Star Trek. Can you change like what tuning system you're in? It has like a thing that says 440 or whatever.
Oh yeah.
That's cool. Yeah, I need to like put it in.
every single one of those. This, like, this is driving me insane.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Yeah, now I don't screw up that much.
Well, yeah, also maybe if you just take it in like sections and look at a few things, because it does repeat a lot too anyway. Like, but I think one thing with this piece that, you know, I've been trying to do as well is like letting it, because there's so much good stuff in it. I'm like, trying to figure out what, where my brain is going to talk about. Like, there are a lot of really high notes, there's a lot of harmonics, slurs, so there's a lot to like bring attention to for the audience. And you don't want to go through it too fast.
Yeah.
So like even in the beginning, like you've got this pretty harmonic chord. It doesn't, you know, initially this part here too, you don't have to be like super in time. Like you do want to be in time, especially when you're practicing it. But maybe hold on to like that really high note first, the G. Give me some vibrato there. A little bit. This is a dotted eighth, And that E is just a little 16th note, so it's like.
So I screwed up on the A again.
Yeah, same thing there. And then same for the half note chords here. There are two whole beats and then you have a chord rest.
Yeah.
So you can just, I wouldn't be in a hurry to get out of that. Yeah.
Okay.
Cool. Does that all make sense with
the
intro?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. And then, let's see. Do you guys have anything to add for the intro?
Yeah, I want to talk a little bit about the intro.
Yeah.
You know how it repeats itself two times.
Yeah.
We could play it like five times, and after each one, say like, okay, that was 8 out of 10. That was 6 out of 10. That was 7 out of 10.
Okay, two. Nope. Well, I screwed up that chord, but six. Mysterious would be a pretty good way to say
it. Yeah, but I think so too. I love that it's this flourish that comes out of nowhere, but later on you can see that those gestures are deeply embedded in this.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that I want to comment on, and it might sound critical, but I'm not going to. I like the way that you play it a lot, and I think that you can make it more effective by tweaking just the little things. And I want to back up again and say, you play the piece awesome, and this is one of the great pieces of guitar music that when people play this, you really hear people put a lot of themselves into the piece. Not a ton of music comes out like that. I think an example of that would be like, the Barrios La Papu Grau. It's going to have the same like crystalline mood no matter who's playing it. But this one, Capriccio Arve, you hear so many different shades of nuance, and I'm getting a lot of that from your playing too. So that's great. I think that the feeling that I'm getting at the beginning of this piece is a little bit like it's a little Russian, I mean, grown.
Yeah.
Begin too deep immediately. And
yeah.
One way that you can like tweak it, you can keep the way that you're playing it. But since it repeats, maybe try to do like the really lively flourish that you do the second time. And then the first time, try to play it more on the page. And that's one thing I love to try and do in a lot of my music. But I will come up with an idea for playing something. And I will memorize the piece that way. It becomes the way that I understand the piece, and I have a write down the piece. I probably write it more my way. And then after I'm sitting with the piece like that for months or years, I'm even embellishing my embellishment and getting further away from that. And, you know, I used to hate doing master classes because I feel like every time I'd be in front of somebody who wasn't used to my playing, then they would comment on that aspect of it. So I'm not going to do that exactly, but I do want to say, like, look at the way that it's phrased at the very beginning and, like, take that as your theme and then give me your variation whenever you repeat it. So when you're playing, if you're playing, like, you know, And that's like two bars, but the whole thing is four or five bars long. It's from and nobody plays it like that. So I'm not saying that it's the right way to play.
Okay.
Nobody plays it like that. The closer that you get to that, I think the more that I will be like eased into the piece. And again, this is what I do with the piece, so take it with a grain of salt, my advice. So, go do that. So, a little bit different the second time. Neither way is exactly the way it is on the score, but something that's easing me into it a little bit more, allowing me to hear that emotion ramp up instead of being full volume. I think that will be easier on somebody who's not familiar with the piece. Also, it'll be easier on you because if you start at a 10, then you don't have very much room to grow from there. So, yeah, those are my only thoughts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a long piece too. So you don't want to start off really intense already.
Yeah.
I mean, you might want to, but it's something to consider.
Yeah. Because
you have a lot of space here and you can like, mm-hmm. you can vary it later on too. And there's a lot of fast loops later on too. Yeah, I don't know. This is something to think about. Oh, well, you played it too. I didn't hear it like that. Yeah. Cool. I guess we're still doing time. Okay. Do you want to play like? Oh yeah, how was this thing? Yeah. When it starts off. That's an upper.
That's hard.
Are you one or open three?
Open one, three, four. One, four, and one, four, three, or whatever. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, I just do it there.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I think the left hand thing, those exercises that we've been doing in the mornings, when adult and I did.
Yeah. Yeah. And even with that, I was having trouble not just lifting everything
up. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, okay.
And then when you move it back, this is where it's really tricky because you're in a plane, and then that finger moves to get out of the way. It moves to the next string for pair.
It's hard.
It's a lot easier going one.
I'm gonna put this on the clock. Let's say like the fifth position and leave these three down and just move the first finger.
Maybe this is Mr. Kagan's finger.
Is it? Yeah, that'll help keep those down.
Yeah.
There you go.
I always get confused with it, but doesn't he like do like that and then
switch? Oh, there's another one, yeah, where you switch. Which that one's fun too. But you could also just do it with one finger and go like fifth string second, sixth string first.
Yeah.
And just try one finger at a time.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You want to play your piece? You know. Did you want to? Okay, well, this is rep. Okay. No, you, well, or do you have any questions on it or anything?
No, it made sense. I need to fix my left hand, I guess. Well,
it's not really good, though.
Well, I'm just kidding. It was annoying that I messed that part up every single time. And I'm still messing it up.
No, it sounds good. I think you can, like, take your time. It sounds great. Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, we did. Oh, yeah, you can use that one or this one. Either one's fine. Let's just look at the first line. Let's look at line by line. So let's look at there to there. Awesome. Your technique is so good. Yeah. I think just like a little tiny thing I'm noticing, like in the right hand, the kind of like what we're talking about with the left hand in Capriccio Rabe, the fingers are kind of going a little far away, and they can stay a lot closer to the string. Some of my students, I'm getting them to do that, like, sequential landing with the right hand. You're doing such a good job of that. Yeah. Let's go ahead and do, let's just do the first half. We'll go from here to here. Like when you play with your thumb, it seems like your hand might be going back a little bit. Yeah, that's better already. And I think that there was an exercise, I was stuck in that one here, maybe it's Mike Taken, where we had our first three fingers here on the first string, and then we used our thumb, and so we practiced thumb swing. But we used our thumb on the bass strings, but kept our hand in the same position. So that was helping us, like when we played our thumb, we didn't like shift out of position. But yeah, that's just something to keep in mind. Yeah, that's awesome. Let's try. Let's see. I'm just thinking. I remember with Mr. Kagan, you had worked in this line and like making, I think it was the G7 here, kind of making it maybe a little louder, a little more intense, and then kind of bringing it back down. I think you can actually do even more of that if you wanted. Like, yeah, like tear out a little bit. You're making it. It's okay to do. I was just like, where did it go? Yeah, so. Oh. You know, it's so small. So
yeah.
Back of it. I think for the whole piece, too, if you could probably play this even louder. And that can be hard at first, but in your right hand, if you just push into those strings a little bit, you'll get even more sound. Pushing into that string a little bit, and you'll get even more sound. Yeah. I think it sounds, does it sound louder? Can you all on the mic breaker? Okay, yeah. Try that. Try this whole line here. Keep that in mind. Maybe we could pick a note, like a mis measure, that could be the loudest that we can kind of reach for. Do you have a note like in this measure of C that you might like to have? I think it's a good
one. Makes more sense.
Because what?
Makes more sense.
Oh, yeah, because it's higher.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, in this measure, you can make that C be the loudest. Like, and then you can start to come back down since that's the end of a phrase. So. Yeah, maybe start kind of quiet here, get a little louder, and then get a lot softer. Yeah. Try that just one more time, and let's see if we can get these two. This is what I always have a hard time in my music with dynamics, is I have to like pinpoint. Like, okay, this one's going to be the quietest, this one's like somewhere in between, and then this one's going to be the loudest. So let's see if we can get that to be the quietest, that one somewhere in the middle, and then C will be the loudest. That's good, yeah, try that one more time. Vibrato too. The end there, you can take an extra little breath before coming back into measure nine. It's kind of hard, yeah. Sure. Wait, that was the only one I meant. That was that one. Yeah. My bad. That's okay. Do you want to start? Let's maybe just this last line. These are all open notes, so if we can get the third finger to kind of prepare in advance here, we can get that chord to be even more connected, like this. So you don't have to wait to get the finger there. Oops, that's okay. can even slow down there too, since it's coming to the end. You can put, you know, a little cardando there, just means to slow down. Like, and even more so, like talking about dynamics, like it's a little harder because there are two notes, so it might feel a little louder than these others. So you might just have to hit those notes a little bit softer than the other ones so that it'll sound quieter. And sometimes that means just barely even plucking the string. This last line, well, is there a measure in this last line that you feel like is similar? Yes, I'm kind of thinking of one, but yeah, that's what I'm thinking too, with the D7. And then we can kind of release that tension in the G. I'm going to give that a try in that last line. Get, like this measure will be applied as, let's see if D7 could be even a little bit louder. And we'll just go ahead and play all the way to the end. So we'll slow down and get quiet. Questions on anything or anything in any spots you'd like to look at? Mm-hmm. Do you guys have anything to add? Teachers or students? I think it's awesome. I think, you know, just playing with some of the phrasing like we were just doing, like, we not only made the ending of this whole phrase quieter and like this part a little louder, we even played inside of the measures and made some of the notes get louder and then some of them quieter. So you can kind of just have fun with that. Yeah, great job.
Thank you.
Do you want to play through it all just one more time?
Sure.
Try to apply all that.
Just an exercise y'all can look at from here as well. It's based on the 1, 2, 3, 4 exercise that everybody does at some point. And I use the parentheses. A teacher here, Craig Bender, actually showed me a cool way to practice these where you don't just play 1, 2, 3, 4 and 4, 3, 2, 1 up or down the string. But if you look at all the different models that the majors can take, and if you guys are in high school, you're doing algebra at some point, you're going to learn about factorials. Factorials is an equation that will show you the maximum possible combinations for any given things, and that's what Kurt Schreiber showed me to do with fingers 1, 2, 3, 4. So there's 24 patterns that you can do with four fingers. And that's what these four boxes are. So there's four groups. There's a one group, a two group, a three group, and a four group. And then I like to apply this to the right hand as well. So, you know, if one, two, three, four in the left hand is, and I think about the right hand.
Thank you.
take a moment to look through what we've got in store for 2 o'clock session, and then also see, I wanted to give you guys a chance here at home, Glenn and John, are there any questions that you have for us as we enter the last hour? This next hour will be some student performances, and that will be the end of our summit. Any questions? No? Good? Okay, so what we're going to do, there will be just a momentary interruption in the feed where we're going to pause the feed here, and I'll join again from the other room on my iPad and stream the Zoom portion anyway of those performances. So we'll see you in just a few minutes, and say by about 2:15, we'll be ready for that. So I'll see you guys there in just a moment.